afternoon. Thank you for being here today. On behalf of the family, I want to thank you for your presence. I came in contact with this wonderful family through the television. We do a weekly television program at the Old Lane Church of Christ that I host every Sunday morning, and John contacted me and asked if I could come and be a part of this special occasion, and I thank you so much for allowing me to be here. I'm with the Old Lane Church of Christ. I want the family and anyone here to know that if we can be of service to you going forward from this day, in your grieving, in your mourning, in your celebrating, let us know. We'd love to help you in any way that we can. We're going to have a prayer, and then we're going to have another song, and then John is going to have a eulogy for his wonderful mother. Let's pray. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we cannot thank you enough for who you are and for hope that comes through your Son. And we thank you for Florence. We thank you so much for the life that she lived. We thank you so much for what she meant to each and every one of us here. And we just thank you so much that you are a God who provides a way and keeps his promises. May we smile as we mourn. May we laugh as we grieve. May we always look to you as our provider, as our strength, as our sustainer. It's in your Son's precious name we pray.
Thank you. those of you who don't know me, I'm John Lloyd, Florence's middle son. And on behalf of my two brothers, Ray and Wayne, along with the rest of the family, I want to thank you all for joining us for this celebration of a long and well-lived life of our mother, Florence Boyd. So since you're here, you probably knew her fairly well. And no matter how well you knew Florence, if you knew her at all, you can imagine that she would want to know who was here. So if you haven't already, please be sure and sign the guest book, as I will be sending a message up to her with a report shortly after we're done. Mom always wanted to know and always had a way of keeping track of what was going on, especially when the three of us were teenagers with girlfriends. Her life began, as most people of her age did, almost 90 years ago, with a very humble start. Mom's story is truly a classic one of the American spirit. Although education was not a high priority at that time for young women, it was clear early on that she was highly intelligent, determined, hardworking, and ambitious. She could recognize that there was a life beyond what she had. She wanted a better life for herself and for her family. Her father, Ray, fell in love with her, and they were married when she was just in her late teens. She always said, Dad was the one who raised her. Providing love, security, stability, a sense of family, and values. We do know that he loved her dearly. And that all came with three small boys. Not too long ago, when Mom was visiting Jean and I in Fort Worth, she said to me, I'm proud of what I've done and what I've accomplished in my life. I've come a long way. Well, not only did it make us feel really good that she was able to acknowledge that experience, but that it was true in so many ways. It's what makes America such a great country. Someone like Florence can achieve a life that she envisioned by sheer determination and faith. Well, after some rocky years, our family came together and Mom went to work as a hairdresser. She was a hard worker and wanted to be the best that she could be at what she was doing. She soon met Margaret Gunn, who owned Park Terrace Beauty Salon. Margaret was a dear friend and mentor to Florence and very kind and supportive to our entire family. They were both active in the Texas Hairdressers Association, where they attended classes, competed in hairstyling competitions, and just had a lot of fun. Mom liked to have fun. Mom was actually active in the leadership of that organization and was president, as well as holding other leadership positions. In 1985, she was named Cosmetologist of the Year by that organization for the entire state of Texas. Well, as Margaret slowed down in her business, Mom took over ownership of Park Terrace. She was a proud business owner and worked really hard to make it the best place to work and to receive the services that she provided. And not only that, but it contributed greatly to our family's happiness, security, and the ability to look to the future. We were all able to have the education that she was denied. And we had endless opportunities. Women like Mom were pioneers in achieving access to the rights that women so rightly deserve, and what many women take for granted today. And during those few years, she had the opportunity to give back to others by providing a place to start in the business, and to be a mentor and friend, just like Margaret had been to her. Julie Wilson is one of those people. Their relationship was and is special to Mom. Mom considered her the daughter she never had. Now, I'm not sure that could have been just a slight dig at the daughter-in-laws, but was for sure quite a compliment for someone who didn't hand them out lightly. During the years that we were growing up, Mom was active in whatever her boys were doing. As a Cub Scout, then mother, helping with the Boy Scouts. And while we were in the band, she was the band's biggest supporter. Dad drove the equipment truck, and they traveled to all of the Cooper Cougar football games and band events. My brothers and I will all agree that Mom was maybe a little too involved with her teenage sons' lives, especially when it came to the girls that we were dating. But remember, she had a need to know. And that was old school parenting, something that our country's families could probably use a little bit more of. There's very, very little that she didn't know about us, and there was never a guess about what she thought about it. She had high standards and expected that we all did too. So some of the attention was taken off of us as we one by one got married and had families of our own. Daughter-in-laws were always an easy target, since they were really never good enough for her sons. Although, after 40 plus years, Jean and Teresa have started to feel like Mom was beginning to accept them. She really did love them. It was just too much fun to pick on them. Mom was active in the community and considered most people that she knew and met as her friends. If she was your friend, you knew it. She was a member of the Abilene Chamber of Commerce Military Affairs Committee. She was on the board of the Ben Ritchie Boys Ranch and on the board of the Chili Super Bowl. Participated in the West Texas Rehabilitation Center, RSVP. And in fact, in 1982 and 83, Mom was honored for outstanding service to the handicapped by the Southwest for the West Texas Rehabilitation Center. She volunteered for the Attorney General's Office Child Support Division, and she volunteered at the Grace Museum in downtown Abilene. Well, after her career as a hairdresser, Mom worked at the Abilene Reporter News, where she met many new friends. Could there be a better job for a mom who had a need to know? Nothing happened at the paper or in the paper without her knowing about it. Mom never wanted to stop working and being active. She was curious and interested, sharp as a tack, even in her advanced age. She loved to work on her computer, doing puzzles, games, and exchanging conversations on Facebook. She was an avid reader. Mom inspired many people towards achievement and community service. She was one of those behind-the-scenes leaders that makes Abilene the place that it is today. In the last many years, Ray was able to keep her company and allowed her to stay comfortably and safely in her own home. It was a true blessing for her. Ray was able to to be a friendly companion to Mom, and he was her personal chef. They both shared the joy of food, as well as an occasional cocktail. Mom was very proud of Ray and all of his accomplishments and community activities. Wayne always kept Mom smiling and laughing. All it took was a call from him to cheer her up and get her talking about her family. I feel certain that he always reminded her of Dad. She was proud of her boys and their families. So Mom enjoyed reading and especially a little book that Jean gave her entitled Jesus Calling, which she read and referred to regularly. And we also gave her a similar book written by Charles Stanley, and she had several Bibles. Her faith tells us that even though Mom was very private about her beliefs, that she had accepted Christ as her Savior, and that she has a special place where she is humbled by the joy that she is experiencing in heaven. And that gives us joy in the expectation that there is life for her, even in death. So it would probably be appropriate if you all would join me for a short prayer. Please bow your heads with me. Blessed be our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with the gift of life, and through his sacrifice, life everlasting. He has blessed us with the gift of our mother, our loved one, Florence Boyd. And Jesus has blessed us with the years we have been able to share this earthly life with her, her long years of life and gifts of character. God, our Father, we thank you now for every member, for every memory of love and joy, and for every good deed done by Florence. We even thank you for every sorrow we have shared, since in those times you have been there to comfort us and to teach us to have faith in you and in your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for opening our hearts to you and for opening your arms to Florence, that we might celebrate the peace and life in Christ that Florence now enjoys. We pray that during this time we might feel Christ's peace, and that all of our action and words will glorify him through all of us. We thank you, Lord, for your love, and we pray that your light might shine through each of us. We pray this in Jesus Christ's name, our Lord. Amen. Thanks for sharing in our mom's life and the celebration of all of the good that she's accomplished, and especially for all of the relationships that endure.
Changing.
was a woman who was diagnosed with cancer. Unfortunately, it was terminal. And by the time the doctors discovered the disease, it was too late, nothing could be done. They gave her 3 to 6 months to live, and so she began to get things in order. She asked if the preacher would come over so she could sit down with him and go through what she wanted to have done in the service. She planned out all the songs, the prayers, who was leading them, all those kind of things. And so they talked for a good while, and it's about time for the preacher to leave. And just as he was about to walk out the door, the young lady said, "Oh, wait, I can't believe I almost forgot this." And she ran to the kitchen and ran back to him and said, "Here." And she handed him a fork. And she said, "I want to be buried with this fork in my hand." Well, he looked confused. He said, "A fork?" And she said, "Trust me, it'll all make sense the day of the funeral." And she handed him a sealed envelope that would explain about this fork. And she asked him to promise her that he wouldn't open it until the day of the funeral. So some time had passed. The woman did pass away. And a crowd had gathered on the day of the funeral. Everyone paid their respects. The preacher did the eulogy. And at the end, he took out the envelope, unsealed it, and read the note inside. It stated, "In all my years of attending church socials and potluck dinners, I always remember that after the tables were cleared and the main meal was finished, someone would inevitably say, 'Keep your fork.'" I love that phrase, she wrote, "because I knew something better was coming. Like velvety chocolate cake or hot apple pie or warm brownie topped with vanilla bean ice cream. Something wonderful and of substance was coming, and I couldn't wait." The letter continued, "So when you walk by the casket and see this fork in my hand, please remember, keep your fork. The best is yet to come." I think the single greatest truth concerning this life is that it's going somewhere. Aren't you glad that it is? Now, don't get me wrong, I love this life. Despite the illnesses, despite the toothaches, the backaches, despite the stress and the long lines at Walmart and the insane amount of taxes that I pay, I still love this life. I have a wonderful wife, 3 kids that love me, and I have a beautiful church family that I get to worship with and serve. I have a Savior, Jesus Christ, whose blood cleanses me from all my sins. It's a good life right now. May not always be. When I'm holding my wife's hand as her heart pumps for the last time, when I'm sitting in a nursing home with very little memory left, when my body has so many miles on it I can hardly walk or even hold my head up, when I'm lying in a hospital bed or hospice care, I may not think it's a good life so much anymore. When all the things that make this life are gone, then what? Well, heaven, right? That's what. What gets us through when everything around us is falling apart? What can we cling to when our life is in shambles? What do we hope in when life seems hopeless? And it's the fact that this life isn't all that there is and that this isn't as good as it gets. The glorious truth is that this life is going somewhere. Now, this is tough. There's just no way around it. Although we know that Jesus triumphs over sin and death, it sure seems like death is winning at times. And I've got to tell you, I'm sick of it. I'm sick of death. I'm sick of what it does to the people I love, people like you. I'm sick of funerals. I'm sick of COVID. I'm sick of cancer. Death is the enemy, and I despise the enemy because of what it does to people I love. But as much as I hate death, as much as I despise it, I know that it doesn't win. And do you know who does? God does. I've looked at the back of the Bible, and guess what? We win. The book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 34, we read of a young king by the name of Josiah. And I say young because he ascended to the throne at 8 years of age. By the age of 21, Josiah had done some incredible things. He was a reformer king. He tore down the altars to foreign gods in high places. He went about restoring Old Testament worship again. And because Josiah was faithful, and because he had a humble heart, God makes him a promise. He promised Josiah that he would, and I quote, "go to his grave in peace and not see all the calamity which God would bring the nation." And so, at the ripe old age of 39, Josiah died from being wounded in battle. And you think about that for a minute. What kind of blessing is this? God comes to you and says, "I want to give you a gift." And you say, "Great, what is it?" And he says, "An early death." And you think, how can an early death or any death be a gift? But God says, "This early death is going to be a good thing because you won't have to see all the destruction I'm going to bring." Death in and of itself is not a blessing, not even close. Death is a curse. Death is the enemy. But because of Jesus, we don't have to fear the enemy because we've already won. Listen to the words of Paul. He says, "For to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. But if I am to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me. And I do not know which to choose. But I'm hard pressed for both directions, having the desire to depart and be with Christ, for that is very much better. Yet to remain on the flesh is more necessary for your sakes." As difficult as it might be, it would probably do us all well to view death from the other side. Because there is hope in death. Although there is a hearse, there is a cemetery, there's flowers and a grave marker, death is not winning. It may seem like it, but nothing could be further from the truth. You know, a large portion of my life as a minister is spent in four places: at hospitals, nursing homes, funeral homes, and cemeteries. And as you can imagine, I'm not real fond of these four places. I love the people that are there, but I'm not real fond of visiting those places because they represent the inevitable. They showcase the end result of living in a fallen world, and they highlight the fact that dying and loss and grief and mourning are an unfortunate byproduct of this earthly existence. When much of your time is spent in hospitals and nursing homes and funeral homes and cemeteries, it's easy to form the impression that death is winning. But it's not. Allow me to say that again. It's not. You can't only go by what you see, because everything I see points to the fact that death has the upper hand. So I don't go by what I see, I go by what I read and what I hear. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away." And he who sits on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." And he said, "Write, for these words are faithful and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give to the one who thirsts from the spring of the water of life without cost. He who overcomes will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son." There's good news from the graveyard. There's hope in every hospital, every nursing home, every funeral home, and every cemetery. And it's this: no more. No more pain, no more death, no more tears, no more suffering, no more sin, no more curse in spite of the fall of man and all the turmoil that that event ushered into the world. We win. In spite of all the trouble and trials and tribulations that we may endure in this life, we win. In spite of all the heartache and all the death and all the hurt, we win. For those who die in the Lord, the message is clear: we win. And Paul expresses this theme vividly in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 and 2, when he writes, "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, and which also you stand, but which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain." And if you skip on down to verse 12 and following, it says, "Now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain. Your faith also is in vain." You can have the streets of gold and the gates of pearl, You know what the best part of heaven is? It's who is there. Don't miss that. He who overcomes will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. The best part of heaven is the relationship. To be with God for all eternity. If you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50 and following, it says, "Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will all be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when the perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." Paul is taunting death. He is sticking his finger in its face, and he is mocking it. Where is your victory? Where is your sting? The original language here refers to a bee that has lost its stinger. And how scary is a bee without a stinger, right? Without the resurrection, we have absolutely no hope. But it's because of the resurrection that we have good news from the graveyard, and that there is hope from every hospital, every nursing home, every funeral home, and every cemetery. If you go back to Revelation 21, where I read from a moment ago, in verse 3 and 4 it says, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away." If you've ever read the book of Revelation, you know that it can be a dark and gloomy book. But quite the opposite is true. It's a beautiful book with the message "We Win" as the theme. It's God's coloring book, and it's God saying, hold on, hang on. There's going to be persecution, but it's going to be okay. Do you know what happened after John wrote these words? You know what happened immediately after this vision, this revelation, faded from his eyes? I'll tell you what happened. Nothing. Not in the beginning, anyway. Christians were still being persecuted. John was still in exile. The emperor was still on the throne. And death seemed like it was winning. Nothing really changed in the beginning. The only thing that had changed is that Jesus had spoken. And don't you think that made a difference in John's life? Even though there wasn't immediate change, don't you think that that lifted his spirits? Don't you think hearing from Jesus in a time of turmoil would make a difference? Don't you think John's joy was renewed? And don't you think the future looked a little bit brighter? The book of Revelation was written for oppressed, for the distressed, for those overwhelmed by life, and for those who had given up hope, people not unlike you and me, people grieving loss. And the message to John, to the Christians in Rome, and to us is this: there is a better tomorrow. Hold on tight. Keep your fork. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you today, we thank you so much for Florence's life. We thank you for all of her friends and all of her wonderful family and for the example that she set. We pray that we can follow her great example. And I think she would tell all of us, may we all follow in the footsteps of Jesus. May we have a glorious family reunion in heaven someday. Heaven is won or lost right here, right now. May we do the things that are about the Father's business. May we seek to please you in all that we do. We thank you for hope. We thank you for life. We thank you most of all for eternal life. And it's in your Son's precious name we pray. Amen.